طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So today we're going to start digging into the sensor platform. So unlike wireless mesh networks, which relies on normal يعني machines or mobile devices such as laptops and so on, sensors are totally different in terms of architecture and design. And that's why this this part, which is covered in one of the chapters in the book, it talks deeply about the sensor node architecture. So we need to understand the architecture of the sensor node. What is the microcontroller? Why we need microcontrollers and not like a different type of processor or a normal machine processor. What is the design of the communication device? What is the design of the sensor node? And so on. So the sensor node architecture has five different components. Of course, the microcontroller is the brain of the whole system. And the microcontroller is just a scaled down computer that's composed of a CPU processing unit and possibly like some DSP and maybe some FPGA and some other peripherals that constitute a scaled down computer on a microcontroller. Microcontroller, of course, is connected with memory, which is used to store the code and the data. And the microcontroller controls two major components. Okay, of course, the communication part, which is composed of two things. Of course, the baseband, where you implement all the layers except for the physical layer, and the baseband of the physical layer, and then the other component is the RF or the radio frequency part. So this is used to communicate the data that's captured using the sensors. So the sensors themselves, they capture the environment characteristics from the environment using different types of sensors like camera, pressure sensor, temperature sensor, and so on. This data is going to be processed by the microcontroller and then moved to the communication device so that it can be communicated to the outside world. So we need to talk about, this chapter is fully dedicated to discuss this architecture in details. So we're going to talk about the different types of the microcontroller, what are the major classes or the major examples of the microcontroller, what is the actual design of a communication device, what is the transceiver, and what, and in each part of this we're going to talk about what's different when it comes to wireless sensor networks, particularly related to the requirements and the things that we talked about before. So for example, in in the communication device or in the microcontroller, how can we provide some energy efficiency? Okay, so what is the energy efficiency reflected? How is the energy efficiency reflected on both the microcontroller, on the communication device, on the sensor itself, and so on?
This architecture is general for sensor network, but for each right. specific for each application, maybe change.
Absolutely. So as we said before, the sensor platforms are very much application specific.
For example, you can remove microcontroller or in memory in some cases, just the sense and transmit the controller.
No. You have to have a microcontroller. There's no work around it. What varies from one application to another is the type of the microcontroller depending on the application requirements. For example, some applications they require less processing. So in that case, you can select a special type of microcontroller which does not have like high processing capabilities. Some applications, they do require you know, very extreme energy efficiency. In that case, the microcontroller needs to have good features in terms of power efficiency, which means that it has to be, it has to have like some sleep modes where it can sleep most of the time and wake up only when it wants to process something. And wake up the parts of the microcontroller that's required to process this amount of information, so and so on. Okay, so we'll talk about that. But in all the wireless sensor network applications, you have to have this architecture. This is the main architecture that has to be fulfilled or supported in all the sensor platforms. So these are examples of sensor platforms that has this architecture. And of course, as you can see, depending on the application, you can, for example, have an ASIC design, or we'll talk about that, a hardware design which is optimized for a particular application, okay? In order to optimize the whole design, the form factor, the energy efficiency, as you can see, that you cannot connect any peripherals to it. You cannot do interfacing to this platform, right? Because it's completely and specially designed for a particular application. Whereas another design like this, this implements the different parts of the architecture clearly, and it gives you some access to some parts of these so that you can interface, for example, some other sensors, some other communication radios. You can connect a different DSP, you can use a DSP chip to do some signal processing and so on. So depending on the type of application that you are targeting, you can select one of these platforms. So these are other types, which are mainly for general purpose wireless sensor networks. So except for this one. Again, this one is this is called dot mode. And again, this is one of the platforms that's designed for specific application on Zigbee. So this supports Zigbee radio, and it supports low data rate sensing. So all the sensor device, the sensing device, and the communication device, and this is the antenna, by the way. Okay, so everything is on this small board. Okay. But as you can see, putting it in such design will prohibit the interfacing with this platform using other devices externally. Okay. Whereas for this sensor board or for this platform, everything is accessible, and you can connect even, you know, a projector. You can connect you know, serial, parallel ports. This is one of the most famous platforms from MEMSEC, which is used for general purpose wireless sensor network applications. We have used this a lot in the past for different senior design projects and MPRP projects. So as you can see, all these you know, interfacing ports allows you to interface different sensors and different radios to it, so that you can increase or decrease the capabilities or the features of such platform. Okay. So what are the characteristics and the main examples of each of these parts? So basically, we're gonna cover the microcontroller, of course, the communication device, and the sensor. So these are the three major parts that we need to understand why we design each part in a specific way. So first of all, the microcontroller, as we said, is a general purpose processor optimized for embedded applications. So it's not it's not like a normal machine or a normal laptop which is designed to move or to process normal data or files or something like this. This is optimized for low rate kind of measurements. Okay, so the microcontroller is optimized for embedded applications with low power consumption. So it's microcontrollers are very small in size. Okay, you can program some embedded software on the microcontroller, although programming microcontroller is much more difficult compared to programming, of course, on normal platforms like Windows. Usually the instruction set of the microcontrollers are small or downscaled in size in order to optimize the microcontroller design and lower the power consumption of these type of processors. Actually, microcontroller is not just a processor. Microcontrollers usually they have built-in memory, they have built-in cache, they have small buses inside, they have some of them, they have even digital signal processing chip built in. They have sometimes FPGA built in. Okay, so you can think of a microcontrollers as small scale motherboard, okay, of a computer in a very very small scale with very limited functionality. Okay, and the purpose of this is, of course, to make it portable and to make it usable in different applications. That's one thing. The other thing is to lower the power consumption. Okay. DSP or digital signal processing. Again, this is an external module which can be built in or connected externally on the sensor platform. Okay. And usually this is a chip which is another type of processor which is optimized to process signals, to process large vectors of data in a short time. So it's not a general purpose processor, it's a specific purpose processor or a small processor for processing the large data or signals, whether analog signals or digital signals. Okay, so DSP, for example, can be used with the microcontroller to process to do some processing on the signals, like for example EEG. So you can use DSP to process EEG. You can do all types of signal processing to the EEG before you send it. For example, you can convert the EEG into the frequency domain, and you can get some features in the frequency domain, and so on and so forth. In 90% of the applications, this is not required. The sophisticated type of signal processing is not required, and that's why DSP chips are not suitable for maybe 90% of the sensor platforms. So this is what we say, that depending on the application requirements, the design or the architecture is different.
Not suitable because of size or high complexity?
Because it's not suitable for applications that does not require sophisticated signal processing, because as you said, like I just want to capture temperature and send it over wireless. Why do I need to process temperature using DSP chip? I don't need any sophisticated signal processing. Whereas, you know, in some applications that utilize AEG and I require to do very sophisticated signal processing on the captured data before I send it, you can do all kind of, you know, network coding or you know, some frequency domain analysis or something like this on the captured data before you send it. So this type of sophisticated processing, you can use DSP. But in, again, in multiple applications, you don't need that sophisticated. Mind you, the DSPs can be used for communication, in the communication part, because in the communication part, depending on the radio, of course, some radio they require DSP to be optimized for the radio. For example, in physical layer, مثلا of Wi-Fi, you need to process, you need to do some processing in the baseband, channel coding, modulation, these kind of things. So that may require DSP, but not for the sensing part. Maybe for the communication part, but not in the sensing part. The sensing part is usually very light. I want to measure temperature, I want to measure pressure, something like this, which does not require the sophistication of DSPs. Okay. FPGA, of course, field programmable gate arrays. These are optimized for hardware design. So if you want to, not just hardware design, reconfigurable hardware design. So you want to you want to do, like, you can use it either for communication, for anything, and you want your communication to be very fast, of course, because DSPs, remember that DSPs, they work on instructions, so they are still like embedded software. You run like embedded software on this DSP. FPGAs, on the other hand, these are hardware, like you can program it using VHDL or Verilog and things like that. But you can reconfigure the FPGA with a different logic gates and so on in order to make your design reconfigurable or changeable. However, of course, programming or changing the FPGA is not as frequent as changing the software. So that's another, this is a lower level of reconfigurability. So, for example, microcontrollers are very easy to program, I mean, relatively speaking. This is pure software. DSPs are specialized type of instruction set for processing signals in using sophisticated signal processing techniques. Okay, so this is a programming. This is much harder than programming a microcontroller. Okay, FPGA is a lower level, which is, again, it's not programmable. It's configurable, and it's of course it's used for fast performance. It's used whenever performance is required or high performance is required, and it gives you some level of reconfigurability. However, of course, the reconfiguration here is not as frequent and as easy as programming like a DSP or a microcontroller. The ASIC design is called application specific integrated circuit, and this is a hardware design which is hard coded, or it's specially designed for a particular application. So that's usually used for the dusts or the very small form factor sensor platforms that are designed for a specific application, and they do not require any kind of interfacing or reconfigurability to be done. Okay. So these are the different designs or the different parts of the microcontroller component. The two common examples for microcontrollers are MSP 430, and this is used for the different platforms from MIMSEC, the one that especially the general purpose ones. So this microcontroller uses 16-bit RISC processor. So there is a RISC processor. Remember, like in the early days, RISC processors were like very, very high performance processors. So now you can use a 16-bit RISC processor on a very small microcontroller chip. Of course, the speed is much smaller compared to the speeds that we are using nowadays, and it uses very small RAM, as you can see, not in the scale that we are talking about nowadays. And this size of RAM is suitable for many applications that uses wireless sensor networks. It has several digital to analog converters. So it uses DACs or digital to analog converters. It uses like reduced time clock. It's reduced compared to, of course, the normal clock frequency of the processors, the normal processors. And the price for it is very cheap. Of course, this is the price of the microcontroller, not the sensor board itself. The sensor board has a lot more than the microcontroller. So the whole sensor board can range maybe from maybe $30 all the way to $100 or $120, depending on, again, the capabilities and the different interfacing capabilities and so on. But the microcontroller itself on the board is very cheap. Okay. So this is the TI MSP 430. As I said, this is used for many sensor platforms. The Atmel is not as famous, it uses like an 8-bit CPU or microprocessor and a larger memory compared to the MSP 430. Although, of course, the clock frequency of this microcontroller is much smaller or much slower, compared to the MSP 430. So MSP 430 tends to be significantly faster compared to Atmel. So that's about the microcontroller. The next thing, or the next component, is the communication radio or the communication device. So depending, again, on the, as we said, the wireless sensor network is very much application specific. So what is the type of radio that we need to use on the sensor board? Can we use electromagnetic? An electromagnetic can be like in radio frequency, like 2.4 gigahertz, the ISM band, or 5 gigahertz. So in the range of the ISM band or above, we can use electromagnetic in lower frequency, actually. In the range of few megahertz, maybe like 80 or 900 megahertz or less. One thing we have to pay attention to here is that what's good and bad about using electromagnetic waves in different frequency? That's a question. So what is the advantage and disadvantage when you use like a higher frequency?
A range, small, high frequency, small range.
Okay, so when you increase the frequency, usually the range of the signal becomes lower. Okay. So when you reduce the frequency, the range of the signal can travel longer distance. So, okay, so let's go with the lower frequency. Why don't we go with the lower frequency? So we can use lower frequency. We can use like 800 megahertz or or something like this, or maybe 400 or 200 megahertz, and go with that. So why do we need to use like Wi-Fi in 2.4 gigahertz and 5 gigahertz and so on, and we didn't use the lower frequency?
The frequency, I think the noise is more noise and more occupied. Maybe reserved for other.
That's one thing. That's one thing. The other thing is that the lower the frequency is, the larger the design of the antenna. Because remember that the antenna design is proportional to the wavelength, and as the frequency is lower, the wavelength is higher, of course, and this makes the design of the antenna more sophisticated and larger, and of course that requires larger size, which means that the whole design of the platform will be large, right? Okay, so let's go with the extreme. The highest frequency is the light, right? So we can use optical communication. Here, of course, by this we mean like optical wireless communication. We cannot afford using fiber optics in sensor networks, of course. So we can use light, okay? What is the problem with light? It's line of sight. Line of sight. Okay? So you have to you have to align the transmitter and the receiver in order to have optical wireless communication. Okay? So it's very much line of sight. So the electromagnetic waves are suitable in many applications. However, another characteristic of the high frequency signals in general, okay, which is all this range are in the high frequency range, right? Another problem is that the higher the frequency is, the more the signal is prone to fading and reflections whenever it actually travels through objects. So when the signal frequency is high, the signal does not penetrate through objects easily. So the range of transmission, for example, in many of the electromagnetic or RF signals can be like up to 100 or 200 meters, which is very suitable. However, if you try the same electromagnetic wave underwater, for example, then the range drops significantly. It becomes, you know, like from 100 meter or 200 meter all the way maybe to 2-3 meters. Okay, so electromagnetic waves, it does not tend to penetrate through the different media or the different objects easily, okay, which deems electromagnetic waves not suitable for applications that require like underwater communication or underground communication and so on. So that's why we can talk about ultrasound, because ultrasound is lower in frequency. It's in the frequency of 2 to 10 megahertz. So in that range of frequency, ultrasound can penetrate easily through different objects. And you can have long-range communication underwater easily using ultrasound. However, of course, you have to deal with the disadvantage that we just talked about, that the transceiver design in lower frequency is larger in size and more sophisticated to deal with the antenna and so on. So these are the different types of signals, and depending on the application, we can use or leverage one of these types. So the radio transceiver is by transceiver we mean like a transmitter and a receiver, and the function of this transceiver is to provide the byte or the bit interface to the communication stack starting from the MAC layer and up. Okay, so all this stack, it provides data in the form of stream of bits, and then the transceiver will take these bits and deal with it in two parts, the baseband part and the RF. In the baseband part, we deal with all types of physical layer in terms of coding, modulation, and so on. And then in the RF part, we deal with analog signals. We have to deal with analog signals. So in the baseband part, we deal with the digital data in terms of bits, and then we transform everything to the analog domain where we have to use RF or radio frequency to process the signal in the analog domain. So the transceiver receives data from the higher layer, convert this data into analog, or it provides the other part where it receives the analog signal on the antenna, and then it converts this analog signal into a stream of bits to send it to the upper layers. Okay? So there are some number of characteristics that we have to deal with whenever we talk about transceiver, particularly for wireless sensor networks. Of course, power consumption and energy efficiency is one of the very important aspects of this communication device. And in order to support energy efficiency in wireless radio transceivers, we always talk about different modes of operation. So the transceiver can be in active mode. Active means that all the circuitry of this transceiver are turned on, open, and ready to do things, whether transmitting or receiving. Okay? It can be in a sleep state. During the sleep state, the transceiver is cannot do anything, cannot do most of the functionality, whether sending or receiving, which means that most of the circuitry is turned off. Or the idle state. In the idle state, part of the circuitry is open and you're not expecting to send anything, but you want to possibly listen for any incoming data. Okay? So at least the receiving part should be turned on, but there is no actual reception happening, because if there is actual reception happening, then you get in the active state.
Because passing from active to sleep is costly in time, in terms of time.
Of course, we'll talk about this. Yeah, so also the switch between these different states is costly, as you said, and depending on this cost, the frequency of turning from one state to another should be carefully designed, right? So for example, if you switch from active to sleep, and then right away something happens that requires you to switch from sleep to active, okay, then you did not spend enough time in the sleep state that really justifies the cost of switching back and forth. Okay. Another issue that the transceiver deals with is the RF carrier frequency. So by carrier frequency, we mean that the signal, the signal in the baseband would be around the zero frequency here. So this is the baseband. So the signal in the baseband, we do all kind of digital signal processing and all the coding and everything in the baseband, right? And then what we do is that we push this signal in the frequency domain around what we call the carrier frequency. So this is the carrier frequency. Okay? So this is the analog domain in the carrier frequency. This is the 2.4 gigahertz or the 5 gigahertz or something like this. And then the antenna will receive the signal as analog signal from this carrier frequency. And then we have to use one of these techniques to process the signal in the frequency domain and extract the baseband so that we can convert the digital data into bits and bytes that we can start processing. So in the carrier frequency, the channel can be divided into different carrier frequencies, which are separated from each other using some guard bands. And this is what we call a frequency domain or frequency division multiple axis. So different machines or different nodes will use different frequencies so that we don't have any interference between these nodes. Or we can use code division multiple axis, in which case all the signals are going to be transferred using the same frequency. So all the signals will be on top of each other. However, these signals are coded in such a way that you have a specific code to extract one signal from the other using what they call code division multiple axis. You can use carrier sense multiple axis where in the MAC layer you can sense whether there is the channel is busy or idle, and based on that you can send or receive data from the channel. So these are different ways for us to manage or to divide the resources of the channel, and that's one of the characteristics or one of the things that the transceiver has to deal with. The point that you just mentioned about changing the state and time for switching from one state to another, this is one of the issues that we have to deal with to design our transceiver. And the transceiver needs to deal with in such a way that, you know, I would love to be in a sleep state most of the time. Okay? Ideally, I would like to be in a sleep state most of the time, unless there is some communication that I'm involved in. Right? But there is a very tricky thing here. You do not know that the incoming signal is a communication that's targeting you until you do what? So you have to receive the signal, right? Decode it, send it to the MAC layer, and the MAC layer will do what? Will extract the MAC layer header, and then it will say, okay, the physical address in the MAC layer header is my physical address, therefore this communication is for me. Okay? So you do not know whether this communication is targeting you until you have to do the whole communication function. Ideally, I would love to keep myself in a sleep mode until someone tells me that, you know, this communication is targeting you, and then and only then I can wake up and process it. But that's not possible. That's not possible. Using the design that we have nowadays, it's not possible. You would love to have an optimized design of a transceiver that says, okay, I will just activate the parts that are required to know that this analog signal has data for me. But that's not existing. This design is not there. Okay? So that's why the transceiver has to have all types of mechanisms which we will talk about, at least some examples of these, which keeps the transceiver in a sleep state, but synchronize this sleep states in such a way that I will be in a sleep mode for some time, and when I wake up because I know that I'm expecting, or there is high probability of some communication that's targeting me, and therefore I need to be awake. Because you can be awake, okay, but nothing is happening. So one of the very important characteristics of the transceiver design is again this intelligence of when to be in the sleep mode, when to wake up. If you wake up and no communication is happening, then you're wasting energy. Because just the fact that you are in idle listening state, you are consuming energy. Okay? And maybe you can be in a sleep state, but someone is trying to send you something, in which case it's wasted. So he or she will not get an acknowledgement, in which case it will retransmit or again, the other node will have to waste energy retransmitting data again. So that's a very tricky point. When to be in a sleep mode, when to be in an active mode, this is one of the major issues of wireless sensor network transceivers. Also, data rates. The transceiver controls the data rates through what? So the carrier frequency affects the data rate. What else? Bandwidth. What else? The coding. What else? Modulation. Okay? So the data rates are function of all these things. Okay? The carrier frequency, the bandwidth, the coding, the modulation, all these constitute the, because depending on the coding, depending on the modulation, okay, the amount of data that you can send per unit time changes. And that's what we mean by data rate here. The data rate is the amount of bits, the actual useful bits that we send over the specific bandwidth using this carrier frequency per unit time. Okay? And that's affected by the different coding and modulation. So for example, modulation here, we have amplitude shift keying, we have frequency shift keying. So for example, amplitude shift keying converts the data. So this is the data, this is the digital signal, and we need to convert this using, for example, some phase shift keying or amplitude shift keying. So with amplitude shift keying, the one, we send one using sine wave, using the carrier frequency as a sine wave, using an amplitude of maybe 3 volts or something. And the zero will be like zero amplitude. This signal shows, مثلا, phase shift keying, where the one is sent using sine wave with a phase shift of zero. The zero is used is sent using a sine wave with a phase shift of 180 degrees and so on. Frequency shift keying converts the digital data into an analog signal such that the frequency of the one, because at the end of the day we only have one and zero, right? So the frequency shift keying uses different frequency to send one and zero. So the one is used is represented using a sine wave with a frequency x, and the zero is used is represented using an analog signal or a sine wave using a less frequency, like x over 2 مثلا or something like this. Okay. So depending on the how you convert the signal as analog signal and the bandwidth that's available for you to transmit and the carrier frequency you are using and so on, depending on all these things, then you can calculate or estimate the data rates or the maximum data rates. Transmission power control as well is another issue that the transceiver has to worry about while transmitting. So this focuses on the actual transmission state. So you are active transmitting. So in that case, you can use specific power control techniques to change the range of the transmission. So if you use higher power, you are sending the signal across a larger distance. If you are using low power, then you are sending through short distance. Okay? So so what's the trade-off here? If you send higher, if you send using higher transmission energy, what happens is that your signal will travel through a longer distance. However, what's the drawback here? Power consumption is a drawback, too. So you are consuming more power, and also you're doing what? You are causing more interference to the other nodes, right? If you, which means that your network becomes the so it looks like this. So you have nodes, you have like nodes like this. Using the only power control. If you use low power control, then you have, based on the power control, you have a logical link between this node and this node, depending on the power that you're using on this link. And you have this link, and you have a link here, right? And then you have a link here, and you have a link here. And you have a link here. So this gives you, based on a certain power, this is the topology of the node, right? If you increase the power, what will happen? If you increase the power, then this node becomes reachable to this node directly. And this node becomes reachable to this node directly. Right? So you are creating more logical links on the network, which increases the possibility of interference. So now this link interferes with this link and this link and this link. So the more links you have in the network, the more possibility of interference. So so increasing the power is good in the sense that it increases the range, but also it may cause some problems in terms of energy consumption and more interference. So that's another trade-off that we have to deal with when we design the communication part.
Mm-hmm. Here it is CDMA, right?
SISMA, yes.
Yeah, Doctor, which one is better, frequency division or code division?
SISMA C is not code division. Code division is not here. Code division multiple axis is not here. This is carrier sense multiple axis. These are two examples. This one is collision free. So so this one is collision free in the sense that you divide the frequency across the multiple users so that they do not interfere with each other. And therefore, when I send, I know that when I send on this particular frequency, I know that no one is trying to send on this particular frequency, so I can send. And there is no collision in that case. SISMA CA talks about the fact that when you send,
you need to check the code.
You need to check, not the code. This is not code. There's no code here.
Got it.
this is the carrier sense, which means that before you send, you have to sense someone else is actually talking over the channel or not. If no one is talking over the channel, then you send. Otherwise, you do not send. But when you send, there is a possibility that another one is sending at the same time, so you can collide with him. Okay, so this talks about collision-based technique, and this talks about collision-free techniques.
Of course, FDMA is much better.
Not really. Again, FDMA, you can allocate certain frequency, and nobody's using it. In this case, you are wasting the frequency resources of the channel. So actually, Wi-Fi uses this. Yes. So this is much more efficient for high data rates than FDMA. Because FDMA, if you allocate frequency band to some user and he's not using it, then it's a problem.
There's always trade-off.
There's no magic solution that works for all. And particularly when we talk about wireless sensor networks. Whenever it comes to wireless sensor networks, everything has trade-offs.
Yeah.
You always have to deal with trade-offs, okay? And that's why optimization is required in many of these. Really, the amount of research in wireless sensor networks is just, I think it's going to go forever because the issues in wireless sensor networks are huge. And again, there's no one-size-fits-all. In wireless sensor networks. So every single application can drive, the design of all these parts in a totally different way. Which means that, if you have finished all the issues nowadays, maybe tomorrow another application will appear which requires totally different things. In the early days, people have been talking about different issues, but now we have cloud computing. Cloud computing has actually reflected different requirements on wireless sensor networks when it comes to dealing with big data and dealing with different protocols to communicate with the cloud and so on. So any application that comes up, it drives a whole new set of requirements that you have to go back to wireless sensor networks and redesign it accordingly. So another characteristic which is used to measure the efficiency of the transceiver is what they call noise figure. Noise figure here talks about the fact that when I send a specific signal to the transceiver, so the transceiver block is something like this, and there is an input signal and there is output signal. Okay? So the transceiver receives an input signal and produces an output signal here. So the noise figure here talks about the fact that the transceiver receives a signal with a specific signal to noise ratio at the input side. And signal to noise ratio means that the transceiver here receives the pure signal, which I need to process, and it receives some noise with it. Okay? So what is the signal-to-noise ratio at the input side? Okay? And then when it processes this signal, it produces an output signal with a specific signal-to-noise ratio at the output side. So if the signal-to-noise ratio at the input side is larger than the output side, then this means that the transceiver has induced or has introduced more noise to the signal, which means that the noise figure is higher.
But it's important to consider noise in hardware. I think noise in the channel
is the
dominant.
You are trying this affects the sensitivity of the transceiver. The sensitivity. Because the transceiver is the hardware design. The hardware design needs to be very sensitive. So we need to talk about the efficiency of the transceiver as a unit regardless of the channel noise. Channel noise is another thing, we'll have to deal with it. But here we're talking about the transceiver design itself. It's mostly in hardware, and we need to make sure that it's sensitive enough that it does not actually introduce more noise. Otherwise, pay attention to the fact that this transceiver is part of the design of a full board. So if that produces a signal with a little bit of noise, this noise might actually might be amplified later on. Okay, so we need to pay attention to the design of the transceiver carefully to make sure that the noise figure is as low as possible. In other words, if the noise figure is less than one, this is the, or the noise figure is in decibel, yani is low. This means that we're not actually introducing noise, we are reducing the noise. Ideally, we would like to reduce the noise that is coming in the input signal. Okay?
And how we can do this?
We have to, in the transceiver, in the baseband part, we have to do some noise reduction. Okay? So we have to really try to separate the signal from the noise and take the signal and process it. But even then, the hardware itself introduces some noise by default. The hardware circuitry here introduces some noise. Even what Ala is saying is that it's much less compared to the channel noise, but it does introduce some noise, right? So ideally, I would like this noise figure to be as low as possible. Okay, so the last type of characteristic here is the antenna gain and range. So, of course, depending on the antenna gain, the gain is like the amplification that happens as part of the antenna. If the antenna gain is high, then, of course, again, this will consume more energy, right? But this will affect the range. The range will be larger, okay? And if the antenna gain is low, then the range is reduced and the energy consumption is lower. So that's another thing that I talk about for the transceiver design. So based on this design, the transceiver then has certain states. The most common states are transmit. In the transmit state, you are, of course, in the active state, of course, most of the circuitry will be on, will be turned on. You have to do a lot of processing here, a lot of signal processing, and a lot of processing in the baseband. And also the antenna is radiating power. Okay? So the antenna here is radiating power. So you are consuming power both on the baseband and the RF. The baseband has to do a lot of processing in terms of signal processing, coding, modulation. You are generating a signal, okay? And also the RF part, the antenna itself is radiating energy. So you are consuming energy on both sides. The receive part, remember here, the receive part, the antenna is receiving. So the antenna is capturing the analog signal. It's not radiating energy. So the amount of energy consumption in the receive part is usually less compared to the transmit part, okay? Idle here means that, well, I'm listening, but nothing is being received on the antenna. So the receive here, so for the receive state, I'm receiving an actual signal, which means that the baseband is working, is functioning, is processing this signal, right? And I have to convert this signal to the digital domain. I have to do some modulation or demodulation. I have to do some decoding and so on. So that consumes energy. In the idle state, I'm waiting for signal, but the signal is not coming. Therefore, I'm idle. Just the fact that I am still in the awake state, I'm consuming energy constantly, but this energy is significantly less compared to the fact that I'm actually receiving some signal. unfortunately, this is one of the trickiest state because so normally I have to be alert and waiting for anything to happen, right? In which case I should spend most of the time in the idle listening state, because I don't know when the date is gonna come. Okay, so even though this idle listening state consumes per unit time less energy compared to the receive state, but if you do like a histogram or a pie chart or something like this, you will find yourself consuming more energy in this state, more than the receive state and possibly more than the transmit state. Why? Because of the fact that most of the time you are in this idle listening state. So I would love to reduce this idle listening state and switch to the sleep state most of the time. I would love to be in this state most of the time because the amount of energy in this state is negligible compared to any other state.
And you are able any time to...
Not zero, but like...
You are able at any time to wake up the device.
That's the tricky part. That's the tricky part. So in the idle state, some functions in the hardware can be switched off. Or actually, it's not switched off. It's not functioning. It's not activated. The energy consumption here is a little lower compared to the receive state. In the sleep state, most of the circuitry and most of the hardware is turned off. So if something is coming on the antenna, you will not be able to decode it, even if it's targeting you. Okay?
In ideal, we listen and sleep, we don't do anything.
It depends, because in some transceivers, they have multiple sleep states. And particularly, actually, not in the transceiver, not in most of the transceivers, but in microcontrollers, come on. They have multiple sleep states. So normally, in the sleep state, not only can we not process the signal, but we have to spend time. There is a recovery time required to start and wake up again. Okay, so it doesn't happen. So you are in the active state, then you go to a sleep state. You don't go to a sleep state like this. You go to a sleep state like this. So this is the power, and this is the time. Okay. So you are in active, while you are in active mode, you are consuming energy during this time. So power times power times time is energy, right? So all this energy is active energy because you are active and processing things, whether you are transmitting or receiving. Once you decide to switch to a sleep mode, the power does not turn off in zero time. So it has to gradually go down. So this is when you turn off certain hardware circuitry until you get to the state that it's in a sleep mode. Okay? So remember that this part is wasted. So during this entire energy part, you're not doing anything. You're trying to switch to a sleep state. You didn't even complete the switching. Okay? So you have to spend some energy until you get to this state. Okay? And then you switch to the sleep state, which again, depending on the sleep state, maybe you can switch completely to zero. You completely turn off. Usually you don't have this complete turn off. You have to have something running in order to be able to wake up again. Right? But then when you try to wake up, you wake up like this. You don't wake up like this. Okay? So again, this part, or this part, يعني, is a wasted energy. So this is the cost that you have to pay. This part and this part are the cost that you have to pay in order to switch to a sleep and from sleep to active again.
The first part is not a problem. You will, it's better than consuming that amount of energy, but the other part is...
Exactly. So, yes. So this other part, yeah, so it's so this part, yes, you're right. You're perfectly right. So this part is better than, you know, waiting in an idle listening mode and consuming energy and not doing anything. Yeah, but this part is totally wasted because you're trying to go to active state to process something. However, you have to spend this energy before you start processing anything.
Energy and time.
Energy and time, of course.
And this is taking like milliseconds.
Of course, we're talking about a few milliseconds. But more importantly, we are consuming energy. So you have this big research question, which nobody has an answer to. I would love to be able to wake up the transceiver via the radio, but only when I know that this radio signal has a digital data for me. Okay, but in order for me to know that this radio signal has a digital data for me, I have to be active and receive it and decode it, and then and only then I can figure out whether it has data for me or not. So this is actually contradicting. This is a big contradiction which, you know, we cannot, we do not have answer to. Similar to what we have done for microcontrollers, some transceiver examples. We have 802.11, of course, the most common. Whether the B...
I have suggestion to the previous slide for the wake up signal. You can use basically the electricity here, electricity signal to pass the wireless signal through electricity.
This is not a new idea. So we have communication, power line communication, and we have this. Yes.
But I mean, for the device that's sleeping, send to the device electricity signal. I mean here.
Yeah. Now we're talking about wireless sensor node. Okay, wireless
so
sensor.
So connected and on battery operated.
Battery operated.
Yeah.
So battery operated. Yes. Yeah. Okay, so for 802.11 B and G and A, of course, B and G, they work in the 2.4 gigahertz band. The A works in the 5 gigahertz band. They support up to 54 megabits per second, which is obviously a very large data rate, although nowadays we have version, I don't know, like AC and F and
E?
802.11e is kind of old now. Yeah, so I'm talking about AC and AF standards, which they can support up to 300 megabits per second. So these transceivers, they support, of course, high data rates. They support relatively long distances. Ideally, well, there are some transceivers that support up to 2 kilometers, which what they call long-range Wi-Fi. However, typically, the range is in the tens of meters, usually around 20 or 30 meters in indoor applications. Okay. They work perfectly. Not as perfect in mobile environments, of course, because of the concept of mobility. Like here in the university, if you move from one access point to another, you always have some interruption and some... it's not like cellular even. When it comes to roaming and mobility and things like that, Wi-Fi is not as efficient as other types of radio. But in many cases, Wi-Fi is not suitable for wireless sensor networks. Why? Because, of course, the transceiver is very expensive, relatively speaking. Because in wireless sensor networks, we need it to be cheap. Why? Because in many applications, we need very large number of these. In ad hoc networks, usually the network is very small, composed of maybe 5 to 10 different users or a small network. But in wireless sensor network, it's usually very large scale. So we need the wireless sensors to be very cheap. And 802.11 is relatively expensive. It's also power hungry. So the amount of energy consumed in this transceiver is maybe in the tens of times of the typical wireless sensor platforms. And why is that? Because simply 802.11, with all its variants, with all its variations, was not originally designed for power efficiency. Okay? It was designed for huge laptops like this. The amount of optimization and power efficiency in these platforms or in these transceivers was not that that sophisticated. In sensor networks, of course, they have talked about Zigbee. Zigbee is one of the most famous standards when it comes to wireless sensor networks because it was designed with the sensor networks in mind, in the sense that I don't need this huge amount of bit rates, so I can design my transceiver in a low bit rate, in which case I can gain some other good features like, for example, the low power consumption, the relatively good range, which can allow me to support multiple applications and so on. Okay, so Zigbee is designed for low data rates and low power consumption. Okay, and of course it supports ad hoc communication in star topology or in mesh topology. So it's very flexible in the sense of supporting multiple topologies. Okay, so the transceiver has a very big issue when it comes to the energy efficiency, particularly related to being idle most of the time, listening to the incoming signal, which consumes considerable amount of power. And if you are not receiving anything, then this power is logically wasted. So the question here is when to switch on a receiver, again, is not clear. So for contention-based MAC protocols, contention-based MAC protocols are based on asynchronous type of communication. Why? Because we're saying that whenever you want to send, you can do what? You can listen on the channel. If no one is sending, then you send. You don't have any restriction to send at specific time. Right? Are you following this? So you're not obligated to send in particular time slots. So this forces the sensor nodes to be alert most of the time, because if there's no restrictions on time slots, then any node can send any data at any point in time, which means that I do not expect when the data is going to come. So in that case, I have to be awake most of the time. Okay, so that's why contention-based and SESMA techniques are not really suitable or not very efficient for wireless sensor networks. Okay, that's why Wi-Fi does not have very good performance when it comes to wireless sensor networks, particularly for energy consumption. As I said, SESMA CA tends to have high data rates, right? Because you do not have allocated or dedicated channel resources to a particular node. So the channel is shared. Whoever has data, they can send. So the utilization of the channel is high. Rather than allocating a specific time slot to a node and the node does not have data to send. So this time is wasted. So TDMA talks about the fact that we have particular time slots allocated to each node. So if the nodes know that, well, that's good news because because then what I can do is that I can simply do this. I can simply say,
work up on my slot. Work when I have slots on my slots only.
Well, you cannot do that purely because you can receive something. Now we want to reduce the idle listening. We want to reduce the idle listening, not the transmission. And the transmission, I know when I want to transmit, so I can sleep and I can wake up only when I want to transmit, and that's it. And that can happen in either way. It can happen even in SESMA. But the problem is idle listening. So I know that the nodes can transmit at these different time slots. I cannot have any node transmitting in the middle. Okay? So in TDMA, what I could do is that I can say, okay, so in idle listening, I can be on idle for as much time as this. If no one is sending me data during this time, I will be in a sleep mode, which means that okay, so what we could do here is that we can say we will listen a small part of the frame, and then we'll be sleeping in the remaining part of the time slot, and then I know that during this time I can be in a sleep mode and then wake up here again, and then listen if nothing is distant to me or targeting me, then I can be in a sleep and so on.
Doctor, a question here: mm-hmm. If you each time or each period you are switching off the
right, but the assumption here is that this time is long enough to justify the fact that I go to sleep and then switch back. Which usually it is. In TDMA, the frame size is in the range of maybe like 10 milliseconds or something like this. So the time is enough for me to go in a sleep mode and then wake up again, and the amount of energy saved will justify the switching back and forth. But the problem here is that TDMA requires huge amount of synchronization. So I need to synchronize my time with the time of all the nodes, all the other nodes. And I need to pay attention to the time whenever I switch to sleep and wake up again and so on. I need to synchronize this time with the time slots, and not the time slots based on my clock. Sir. I have to synchronize this time with other nodes, because if I wake up and start my time slot and there is some clock drift, then I'm listening while there's no data, and then when I go to sleep actually the other node started the time slot and it's sending something to me, and then so it requires really careful synchronization. So in that case, it's desirable that the receiver can check for incoming messages when the signal detected. Not only that, not only when the signal signal detected here means that the signal coming is actually for me, which means that the signal has some data for me. Because remember that you are in a network, and maybe the sensors are sending to each other, right? But there is a signal, and the antenna detects that there is a signal, right? But this signal does not have any actual data for me. Just the fact that I'm in the range of this signal, I was able to listen to it. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the signal has some important data for me. And that's the trickiest part, because I have to be always listening to these signals, detecting, and the antenna detects the signal, sends it to the baseband, and the baseband decodes the signal, and then and only then you realize, I don't have the physical address in this data is not my physical address, in which case I didn't have to receive the signal. But this question is not clear when, and that's why people have been doing lots of research when it comes to synchronizing these duty cycles. Whether using, of course, many people have worked on TDMA because it's still attractive in the sense that at least I have some predetermined time slots where I can expect the transmission to happen. So in which case I can be in a sleep mode most of the time. Or even in SISMA CA, you can sort of, you know, exchange the duty cycle between the nodes together in order to maximize the sleep time. So many people have done several works regarding maximizing the sleep time. Okay, so we'll stop here just to give Ala the chance to go through his presentation. And then we'll continue next time.